Greetings, everybody, and good evening. As you know, this is the final First Wednesday lecture of 2015, but we'll recoup again next month on January 6th, and we'll have another, we'll start the 2016 event, so reserve that evening as well. But for the last lecture of 2015, I think we've perhaps saved the best. We have tonight Glenn Andrus of Middlebury College, who is the author, along with Curtis Johnson, of the seminal tome on Vermont architecture called The Buildings of Vermont. And we have two copies here in the library, one in reference and one that you can take out. And tonight he will talk about those great architectural wonders of our land. I say this every time, we are so fortunate to have the Vermont Humanities Council in the state to sponsor these lectures. And I'd like to thank our fundraising arm of the library, the Friends of Brooksmore Library, for getting the local support to support it. You know, we are in our second annual appeal, and the funds that are donated go to support programs such as these and the services that the Friends like to offer to the community. Tonight, we also have the 2016 Book Lovers Calendar, so if you're so inclined and you haven't bought any holiday gifts, this would be a good one to do. And this weekend, Friday and Saturday, we'll have our holiday book sale. I'd like to thank our other sponsors sponsored the talks for First Wednesday. Brattleboro Camera Club, the Brattleboro Retreat, Brattleboro Savings and Loan, Downs Rackman Martin, New Chapter of the Wyndham World Affairs Council. And the statewide sponsor is the Vermont Department of Libraries and National Life Group Foundation. And my final thanks for helping to underwrite this specific lecture is a very local foundation who you may be familiar with, and that's the Crosby Gannett Fund of the Vermont Community Foundation. So we do have feedback forms, so I hope you will fill one out. That helps us plan for next season's topics. And we have a guest register that the Vermont Humanities Council likes us to pass around. So before you go, please complete one of those. So I mentioned January 6th. That will be art historian Carol Berry, who will speak on the influence of Vincent van Gogh and the artist he influences, as well as the influences that come down from him to this day. So finally, I'd like to introduce Middlebury College professor Glenn Andrus. He has taught there primarily in the areas of architectural and urban history at Middlebury since 1970. His research spans from the Italian Renaissance through 19th century America to postmodernism. He holds a bachelor's degree in architecture from Cornell University and a PhD in architectural history from Princeton. His doctoral dissertation on the Villa Medici in Rome was pursued while a fellow at the American Academy in Rome. So I'd like to welcome Glenn Andrus tonight to Brattleboro.
Thank you, Jerry. It's a pleasure to be here. Can you hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay. And is this moved back far enough so that you can see the screen? Okay, good. I think most of us acknowledge that Vermont is a special kind of place. And it becomes particularly apparent when we leave the state. The National Trust twice called Vermont an endangered national treasure. It's the only entire state ever to be so listed. And it was done in an effort to preserve its vulnerable character in the face of the onslaught of national tastes and values. This evening, I'd like to explore one of the powerful reasons that it is so special, but also so vulnerable, and that's its built environment. My colleague Curtis Johnson and I were involved for some 20 years working on the book Buildings of Vermont for the national series Buildings of the United States, published by the Society of Architectural Historians. It's a series that's intended to make America aware of its architectural heritage. And it was inspired by and modeled upon a series that some of you may be acquainted with if you've traveled in Britain. They have this series called The Buildings of England, Scotland, and Wales that is a county-by-county survey of the British Isles. It was part of a World War II effort to make the British proud of their heritage. very parallel to their famous movie versions of the great Shakespearean plays and so on, again, to rally the Brits during World War II. But it has become a standard travel reference over there. And our book is essentially a history of Vermont architecture in the guise of a travel book. It's structured like a travel book, trying to represent every period, every genre, and every region of the state. Vermont presents a daunting amount of material to wade through. We have over 40,000 buildings on the state and national registers, and that doesn't include anything of the last 50 years. Now, other states may have as many, and maybe they have more buildings by starchitects, but they also are more diffusely scattered, and they often have lost their contexts. In strong contrast, it's probably safe to say that Vermont has the greatest density of historic structures of any state in the Union. Now, they're not all necessarily masterpieces, but they're all important for creating the environment in which we live and work. Other places cherry pick to find their surviving significant buildings, but the joke among preservationists in Vermont is that we should really register the entire state as a district and then note the exclusions. It would be much simpler than individually listing all the eligible structures. This historic environment is important nationally, not only because it's pretty, but also because with its long history and the fact that Vermont has gone through just about every experience that's represented in the nation, this state preserves a microcosm of the American experience. We have a string of buildings recognized as national historic landmarks by virtue of their historic connections as well as their state of preservation. Things like the Emma Willard House in Middlebury from 1811. This was the home of the first institution of higher education for women in America. Or Robert Frost's cabin in Ripton, where the poet summered and wrote between 1939 and 1963. Or the Socialist Labor Hall in Barrie from 1900, a famous anarchist community center. And of course, Nalaka in Dummerston from 1892, Rudyard Kipling's favorite home, and the place where he wrote Jungle Book and Captain's Courageous and Just So stories. Among the National Historic Landmarks as well are the St. Johnsbury Athenaeum and the upper two images here. This is from 1872, and it has what is likely the most intact 19th century art gallery in America, filled with collections that the Fairbanks family acquired in order to educate their townsmen and still hung the same way that they were hung when the building opened. And below that, we have the village of Plymouth Notch with the Coolidge Homestead, which has correctly been called, I think, Vermont's Brigadoon, because time has just stopped there. It is so perfect. But beyond the National Historic Landmarks, and there are several handfuls of those, we also have buildings in the state that are recognized for their sheer quality. For instance, we have great structures representative of early New England, the Rockingham Meeting House from 1787, the Georgian-style John Strong Mansion in West Addison from 1796. We have some of the finest federal period architecture in the country. Churches like the Old First Church in Bennington, 1804 to 1805. These two images are of the Bennington Church. But then also this little gem on the green in East Pulteney, the Baptist Church from 1804 to 1805. We have superb federal-style houses like the Chase House in Randolph Center from 1804. Grassmont in Burlington from 1804. This was built for a patron of Boston architect Charles Bulfinch, and it uses all of Bulfinch's contemporary vocabulary that he was using at that time in Boston and Salem, except that most of those houses have been torn down, and this one still stands. There's the handsome Monroe House in Shaftesbury from 1807, and of course, your Dinkin Holbrook House, Brattleboro here, 1825. a very unusual house with its shaped front wing and this beautiful, delicate porch on it. The Vermont State House is considered one of the best examples of the Greek Revival in America. Its portico is based on actual measurements of the what's called the Thyseum in Athens from the 5th century BCE. It was designed by Amabe Young and built between 1833 and 1838 while Young had his offices in Burlington. It burned in the 1850s, and it was rebuilt by Young's protege, Thomas Silloway, in 1857, who elevated the dome. Originally, it had a Roman saucer dome atop it. But Silloway, 4 years later, carried out major remodeling here at the Brattleboro Retreat. Okay, the State House is joined by such other notable Greek Revival structures as the Follett House in Burlington, 1840, by Amabe Young, the Wilcox Cutts House in Orwell, from 1843, by James Lamb, the Equinox Hotel complex in Manchester, built developed between 1839 and 1853, creating an entire Greek Revival village scape. It's like a virtual movie set. It is so perfect. And then, of course, your beautiful Windham County Courthouse, actually an 1825 federal style building. One can see that with the fanlit door here, for instance, but that was remodeled and went Greek in 1854. There are sophisticated Greek Revival churches, like South Congregational Church in St. Johnsbury from 1851, the Shoreham Congregational Church from 1846, and in the center here, we have the Burlington Congregational Church from 1839. The Ionic columns of this facade were based on those of the Erechtheum in Athens from the 5th century BCE. And the belfry is based on the choragic monument of Lysicrates from the 4th century BCE in Athens. But when we talk about churches, the Greek Revival churches had competition contemporarily from the Gothic Revival, with such notable structures as St. James Arlington from 1829. This is one of the earliest statements in the Greek Revival style for churches in New England. It was built by an Englishman, actually, who negotiated his return ticket as part of the contract. And here we have St. Paul's in Wells, this lovely tiny church from 1841. Built by an English immigrant architect builder, John Kane. This is particularly notable for this great window in the tower. Can you imagine what that's lighting inside? Nothing. And in fact, it's not a real window. It's just a blind window that he put in there to make the facade work the way he wanted it to. Then we have St. Michael's here in Brattleboro from 1858 by New York Gothicist Joseph Coleman Hart, who had just published a book entitled Design for Parish Churches in Three Styles of English Architecture. In this case, he used an unusual timber and brick Tudor type construction for the church. 2 years later, in St. Albans, he would build St. Luke's in a more typical stone architecture. And then we have North Congregational Church on the lower left there, from St. Johnsbury. This built 1877 to 81 by Lambert Packard, based on an unbuilt design by Henry Hobson Richardson for a major church in Buffalo, New York, except that Richardson's was going to be Richardsonian Romanesque, and he converted it instead with pointed arches to make it Gothic Revival. As for domestic design, besides being the self-designed home of one of the 19th century's most important statesmen, the Morrill Homestead in Stratford, built between 1848 and 1851, is one of the finest, best preserved, and most complete expressions of the Gothic Revival villa to be found anywhere in the United States. The 19th century, of course, brought us mills and factories, from the small and picturesque, like the Old Red Mill in Jericho from 1885, to the Grand, the Holden Mill in Bennington, built 1865 to 77, serving as the centerpiece for a neighborhood of workers' housing and a company store besides. And then, of course, you have the distinctive set of slate-sided buildings from the SD Organ Works here in town, built between 1870 and 1873. Of course, if we have industry, we also have industrialist mansions. Things like the Park McCullough Mansion in North Bennington from 1864 to 65 in the French Second Empire style. We can recognize it with the mansard roofs. This was financed by a mining and railroad fortune earned out west. Or the Wells Jackson House in Burlington, 1877, that was built with the profits from patent medicines. Or Gray Gables in Richford, built 1890 to 92 with a lumber milling fortune. And then there's the Edward Wells House in Burlington, 1892 to 93, financed by banking and patent medicines. Agriculture has provided us with a fabulous catalog of barns, ranging from the early English and bank barns of the late 18th and early 19th centuries. These are very simple buildings that are directly expressive of their function, so that, for instance, with an English barn, it has an eaves side entrance, and it's non-symmetrical. This is the drive. To the left, the smaller section is for the animals. To the right, the larger section is for pitching off the hay. Now, you take that, and if you put it on one of the Vermont hillsides, you can gain an extra floor underneath for more livestock, and it becomes a bank barn. As I say, they're extremely simple buildings, but they've got these beautiful timber frames inside. Of course, we have specialized barns too, like the round barn that is now the visitor center at the Shelburne Museum, but it was built in 1901 as a dairy barn in East Passumpsic. This composed barn, the Munson barn from Wallingford, 1888, it actually was made by taking several English barns, moving them together and tying them together then with elaborate Victorian architecture to come up with this single great landmark barn. And talking about landmarks, we have the Whitcomb Monitor Barn from 1903 in Richmond. That is such a landmark from the interstate. And then the immense gambrel-roofed Robinson Barn in Woodstock from 1903. This is a bank barn par excellence. It's entered on four different levels using the way it's built into the landscape to make it accessible at grade on all four levels. And we have great gentlemen's barns, like Joseph Patel's French Second Empire Morgan Horse Farm Barn in Weybridge of 1878, and of course the huge farm barn at Shelburne Farms, 1887. This thing, of course, also had side wings with all the operations for the Shelburne Farms estate in it, but the forecourt of this barn alone enfolds 2 acres. We have well-preserved works by master national architects. Buildings like the Billings Library at the University of Vermont by Henry Hobson Richardson. After the State House, this is probably the second most famous building in the state of Vermont. Built 1883 to 5. In order to execute this, Richardson brought stonemasons and elaborate woodworkers to Burlington, and they stayed on. And they built many of the great houses in Burlington on the hill afterwards. We have Bostonian Peter Banner's Unitarian Church at the head of Church Street in Burlington. This is from 1816. This was a design that won a competition with another design submitted by Charles Bullfinch. This building recalls Banner's series of significant federal style churches in the Boston area that he did for the Unitarians, except that those have all been severely altered, where again, this preserves much of its original appearance. We have Richard Upjohn's Emmanuel Episcopal Church in Bellows Falls, built 1862-7. Richard Upjohn was the dean of the early Gothic Revival architects in America. He modeled the distinctive tower here on the Tower of Ely Cathedral in England, and then he went on to use it as the prototype for the now lost tower of the Church of St. Thomas on Fifth Avenue in New York City. This one still exists. We have a pattern of buildings by national figures that extends right into the 20th century, including important moderns and postmoderns. So we have Pietro Belluschi's Crossett Library at Bennington College, built 1957-59, a prize-winning nationally prize-winning design. We have Edward Larrabee Barnes's Cathedral of the Immaculate Conception in Burlington from 1977. And here from Hardwick, we have Peter Eisenman's House 2 from 1969, perhaps the most famous single postmodern house in America. However, we also have a body of equally exciting structures by Vermont masters who deserve to be nationally known. Laevius Fillmore, who built the Middlebury Congregational Church, 1806-1809. This was the finest of a string of churches that he built in Connecticut and Vermont in the 1790s and into the first decade of the 19th century. We have Thomas Dake of Castleton. This is his Langdon House from 1823 with its fashionable shaped front. The building is manipulated in this way to accommodate the fashion for shaped parlors as they billow out through the facade of the house. But Dake built at Castleton, he built virtually an entire village with some of the most beautiful federal style detailing to be found anywhere in New England. Then we have John Henry Hopkins, Vermont's first Episcopal bishop. This is his Church of St. Thomas in Brandon that he designed and then was built between 1860 and 1863. But Hopkins, soon after he arrived in Burlington in the 1830s, published America's first book on English Gothic architecture and became a national advocate for English Gothic architecture as the only appropriate style for the Anglican Church in America. Clinton Smith, who built Shard Villa in Salisbury in 1872. This is one of over 100 documented buildings we have by Clinton Smith in Vermont across the state. Before he was called by Redfield Proctor to become head of construction for the War Department in Washington, D.C., and then started building army bases across the country. We have an amazing body of work by Lambert Packard of St. Johnsbury, synthesizing motifs that he gleaned from the works of Henry Hobson Richardson. The upper two images here are his Fairbanks Museum of 1891. Here we have the Judevine Library in Hardwick from 1896, which is a charming miniature version of a famous Richardson Library in Quincy, Massachusetts. And here we have the voluptuous Queen Anne Estabrook's house, one of a whole series of Queen Anne houses that he built up and down Main Street in St. Johnsbury, this one in 1896. We have nationally important building types, like Old Stone Row at Middlebury College, built between 1814 and 1861. This represents, well, it exists as one of the best extant examples of what was called the Yale Row. The Yale Row is a famous prototype for campuses at the beginning of the 19th century, with a broadside dormitory, a gable front chapel, a broadside dormitory, a gable front lyceum or academic building, and another broadside dormitory. Middlebury's row is only three: dormitory, chapel cum academic building, and dormitory. Yale demolished its row overlooking New Haven Green in the early 20th century, and other schools have remodeled their rows so much that they're hardly recognizable, but this one is in the spitting image of Yale. We have the Stone Village in Chester from the 1830s, a cluster of buildings in rare Scottish snecked ashlar, brought to this little pocket of Windsor County by Scottish masons who came to build a mill and stayed on and built a whole cluster of houses, church, schoolhouse in this village. We have the breeding barn at Shelburne Farms. At the time of its construction in 1891, this was touted as the largest clear span interior space in the United States. It held that crown for only 2 years because the 1893 Chicago World's Fair had a manufacturer's hall that was much larger than this. But this, I don't know how many of you have ever been in this, but this is a truly remarkable space. We have St. Mark's Church in Burlington, built 1941 by Vermont architects Freeman French and Freeman, working closely with the young priest, Father William Tenian. They were seeking modernist forms that would be suited to the Catholic liturgy, and they consulted very closely with the national liturgical experts as they were designing this church, and came up with a cruciform church around a centralized altar. It was seen as a pioneer that was nationally published as an important prototype for the modern Catholic Church, published in the New York Times, in Time magazine, and in Architectural Forum magazine, among others. It anticipates ideas from Vatican II by decades. Then we have Prickly Mountain in Warren. Built originally between 1965 and 1971 by a group of young Yale architects who are intent on having a design-build experience. And they set out to create a whole complex of what they called purposefully wacky vacation homes. But they were picked up and they were internationally published. These houses, a couple of them have been lost, but others have been converted into more permanent materials and still exist in a cluster on Prickly Mountain, probably the best collection of hippie houses in the United States. And they served as the basis for a brief architectural program at Goddard College, begun in 1970, for architecture without drawings. And their first project was a student design build project to build their own studio building using all donated materials. And this also was picked up and published internationally. It's an internationally famous building. But there's more to our built scene than important individual buildings. Vermont abounds in complete village scapes. We have this pattern of small, vital urban centers quite evenly scattered across the state, and each a distinctive place with its own character. Places with characterful downtowns like, well, you recognize this one, Brattleboro. Okay, here's Rutland with Vermont's one skyscraper, the Art Deco service building. Here's tiny Fairhaven, and here a bit of Main Street in St. Johnsbury. These are places of surprising scale and sophistication for such small communities. Thinking of small communities, let's look at just one here. Windsor. Within a few blocks, one can find important buildings by national figures. There's Asher Benjamin's Congregational Church, built 1797 to 98. Asher Benjamin published America's first architectural copybook in 1797, and in it he included an important meeting house plate that served as the model for countless meeting houses built across the Northeast and extending all the way west to Wisconsin. He took up residence in Windsor between 1800 and 1802, and while there he advertised what was likely the first architectural school in New England. There's two blocks away, there's Alexander Parris's St. Paul's Episcopal Church, built between 1820 and 22. This is the first very early statement of the nascent Greek Revival style in Vermont, and it marked a turning point in the career of this famous Boston, formerly federal style architect who would become a pioneer and one of the most important practitioners of the Greek style in the United States. There's Ami B. Young's post office and federal courthouse from 1856 to 7. It's reputedly the oldest continuously operating post office in the United States. It's by Ami B. Young, who launched his national career in Burlington, and then after he finished the Vermont State House, he won the competition to build the Boston Custom House and moved to Boston, moved his office to Boston in the late 1830s accordingly. Then he became runner-up for the expansion of the Capitol building in Washington, D.C., and his consolation prize was to be named architect of the Treasury Department, essentially national architect, and spent the rest of his career building post offices, custom houses, and other federal buildings across the nation. And then there's the public library in Windsor from 1904. This is by Henry Bacon, who 10 years later would build the Lincoln Memorial on the Mall in Washington, D.C. This set of buildings alone is enough to make an architectural historian's heart leap. But there's much more to this remarkable village. For example, we have the Windsor Cornish covered bridge of 1866. It was the longest extant covered bridge in the United States until 2008, when some Ohioans built a longer one. Yeah, that's why I say, oh. But there's the rare federal style Pettus Journal commercial block from 1824 with beautiful paneled brickwork on it. There's the Robbins and Lawrence Armory, now the American Precision Museum, from 1846. This was a site of important developments in mass production, and it's powered by the 1834 pioneering Ascutney Mill Dam. It's the oldest gravity arch mill dam in the United States. There's the impressive Greek Revival Windsor House, built as a luxury hotel in 1836, and there's the charming Gothic Revival Townsend McIndoe House of 1847 that has some of the finest gingerbread in Vermont. Or, let's look closer to home, Brattleboro. As my passing references to a few of your buildings so far may suggest, this is a town filled with architectural treasures. Some of them are generally recognized. Many of them are unsurveyed. We have a very interesting situation in this part of the state. As the oldest settled part of the state, the southern counties were the first ones to be surveyed historically and to have their buildings put on the state and national registers by the newly formed Division for Historic Sites in the 1960s, in the late 60s. At that time, though, people were focusing only on the oldest buildings and the most outstanding landmarks in the state, cherry-picking only the most obvious examples and listing them with relatively little historical research. This had been their pattern up into the mid-70s, and then they came to Middlebury. They came to Middlebury and they said, well, we want to list about a dozen buildings. And we said, you can't do that. And we took them around and talked them into a district that had over 300 buildings, and it blew their minds, but it set a new pattern, and they started recording whole communities. But they hadn't done it down here, and they haven't done it yet. You know, since then, the process has become much more sophisticated, much more scholarly, with an understanding that intact town fabrics and buildings of all genre contribute to our understanding of our history. And the more closely that we look, the more surprising and important examples and stories come to light. Subsequent to the initial surveys, parts of Brattleboro have benefited from further study. There's a wonderful register district for Main Street, for example, very complete and very well done. There is a district for the Brattleboro Retreat. There's the Clark and Canal Street district that was triggered by the action of the Area Land Trust at a time that this neighborhood was threatened by a proposed mini mall. There's the West Brattleboro Green. But much of the fabric of the town is unrecorded and under-researched. And this recording is important. For once we can know something about a building or a neighborhood, it takes on significance. And it's more likely to be treated with understanding. When we can know something about something, it becomes important. And Brattleboro deserves this. It's a place to find the very old, and the very new. For instance, only relatively recently has the Stoddard-Goodenough House come to state attention. Built about 1785, it's among the oldest houses in the state, and it's remarkably well preserved. It's also fascinating for its unusual qualities. It was built into a bank. So from one side, it's kind of a story and a half cape type of house. From the other side, it's a full two and a half story house. Also, the house was built for Jonathan Stoddard and one of his sons, and it was split vertically down the middle. So that you have a staircase in each end of the house. You've got a complete house in each end of the house, and they were all served by the same great central chimney that went up through the whole thing. And it's still in a remarkable state of conservation. At the other end of the chronological scale, we have the J. Parker Huber House from 1999 by sculptor, landscape artist, and architect Michael Singer. This received national recognition when it was published as a record house by Architectural Record magazine in 1999. In between, one finds one of only two cobblestone houses in Vermont, a type of construction that was more typical of upstate New York in the 1830s and 1840s. And we have this unique and delightful synthesis of Gothic and Italianate motifs in this house with a shaped front, okay, with Italianate brackets, an Italianate Belvedere, and then this wonderful Gothic gingerbread porch on it. There's one of the most sophisticated shingle-style houses in the state, and this is a state with relatively few high-style shingle-style houses. This is the Wyatt House on Putney Road from 1894 by MIT-trained architect Francis Crosby, who opened an office in Brattleboro in the 1890s and probably was responsible for many of the fine end-of-the-century houses that you have, like those in one of the finest Queen Anne districts in the state. Brattleboro, with this neighborhood, competes with the likes of St. Johnsbury, with the lights of the hill in Burlington, except that, if anything, this is more concentrated. House after house after house is a distinctive and really quite marvelous Queen Anne building. The Brattleboro Retreat has buildings from 1838 onward, ranging from the Federal through the Federal style, through the Colonial Revival style, with remodelings that were carried out, but that has all been beautifully studied in the National Register listings for this. But it has a significant history of asylum and hospital design that is important to our understanding of this design across the country. You have three buildings by Worcester, Massachusetts architect Elbridge Boyden. His First Baptist Church of 1870, this part right here at least, in the Gothic Revival style. And then it was expanded and reworked in 1889 by Vermont-born architect Charles Wentworth, who at that time was in partnership with Ralph Adams Cram. Ralph Adams Cram was the leading Gothic revivalist in the country in the late 19th century. It had Tiffany windows, a great Esty organ, and after the remodeling of 89, it boasted, quote, that it was the most costly and elegant specimen of church architecture this side of Rutland, if not in the state. Okay, then there's Elbridge Boyden's Brooks House, 1872, a luxury hotel that was built to compete with other grand hotels in the Northeast in the French Second Empire style with its distinctive mansard roofs and mansard corner tower there. And then also the Brooks supported ex-Unitarian Church, 1874, in its robust stone Gothic style. The boom days of mid to late 19th century Brattleboro gave the nation four of its most important artists of the times. And I don't imagine, after I've seen all the brochures and the walking tours and everything else, that you really need to become acquainted with these, but there was William Morris Hunt, who was trained in France in the Barbizon style and became an important tastemaker in American painting based in Boston. His brother, Richard Morris Hunt, became architect to the Vanderbilt family and other robber barons, building in places like Newport and New York City and Asheville, North Carolina. This is his breakers at Newport that he did for the Vanderbilts in the 1890s. There's Larkin Mead, you know, who sculpted your famous snow angel in 1856 at the head of Main Street, later to be copied in marble, and I was able to admire it in the window of the library here. And then there was his brother, William Rutherford Mead, who became a partner in the firm of McKim, Mead & White, perhaps the most important and prolific firm of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. And this, of course, is their late lamented Penn Station in New York. Well, the Hunts didn't leave their mark on Brattleboro, but the Meads did. Larkin, okay, made a permanent stone copy of the Angel, but he also carved the tomb of Jubilee Jim Fisk in 1872. William, who became the partner in McKim, Mead & White, designed the Wells Fountain at the head of Main Street in 1890, and he almost certainly designed the Colonial Revival Canal Street School of 1892 that has a columnar porch, a rounded columnar porch, like those that at that time he was putting on his Taylor House in Newport, this 1886. He put it on the New York State Pavilion at the World's Columbian Exposition in 1893. He topped the building with a distinctive cupola that was based on the minor domes that were designed for Madison Square Garden in New York and the minor domes of the Rhode Island State House from 1891. So you have quotations from famous McKim, Mead & White buildings here on your Canal Street School. And then there's Main Street, which is remarkable for its urbanity in such a small community, with commercial buildings that span from the 1840s onward, so that we can find references to Greek Revival, Italianate, Second Empire, and some reflections of the Chicago style and Louis Sullivan, all worked into these few blocks. Many of the ground floors have been altered over time, but there's still fabulous original detailing on the upper floors that make these buildings incredibly photogenic. And then there's arts and crafts. Now, there's not much arts and crafts work in the state of Vermont. But you have houses, bungalow and arts and crafts type houses from that period, and the Unitarian, former Unitarian Parish House from 1913. Then you get into the wonderful Art Deco Lattice Hotel, 1938, one of only a handful of high-style deco buildings to be found in the entire state. I hope this sampler can convey a sense of the richness of the state's built heritage. Its very density makes the settings as important as the individual buildings. This kind of complete historic environment's highly vulnerable and has suffered very seriously across the nation. As we change our patterns of living and commerce and follow the conventional tastes of the times, we find that Americans have diminishing value for or patience with our older structures. And in this, our state has been very, very fortunate, perhaps because Vermont historically has had a relatively slow economy and a slow population growth that put less pressure for change on some of these buildings. At this, you know, while it's always had a history of progressive taste, I mean, we've got significant examples of every taste nationally, you know, throughout the whole period of the history of the state. While it's had this history of progressive taste, it also has cultivated an attitude of use it up, wear it out, make it do or do without. Though that doesn't necessarily mean that we're immune to the pressures. For instance, our barns are a threatened species as farming patterns and technology change. Without an ongoing use, we find them decaying in our fields. At the same time, ironically, they're being prized for their marvelous frames, which is a danger in itself because they're being dismantled and re-erected as houses elsewhere. For instance, there's a Vermont barn on the banks of Puget Sound. But because of the threat to this important part of our distinctive landscape, the state has established a program of barn grants dedicated to helping owners preserve these precious pieces of our rural working landscape in place. And more recently, the state has also launched an ambitious barn inventory to catalog and document our shrinking stock of historic agricultural buildings. Then too, we have owners who have tired of or are unable to maintain and live with their fine Vermont houses. And they're ready to sell them to people from elsewhere who value them and wish to take them home with them. Thus, we have Asher Benjamin's 1801 Hubbard House from Windsor. It was dismantled and re-erected in New Canaan, Connecticut in 1956. 2 years ago, the landmark Saunders House of 1850 on Route 116 in Bristol was dismantled for reconstruction in Essex, New York. On a broader scale, our current patterns of life encourage moving out of our compact villages and subdividing our countryside for housing developments and trading our main streets for commerce that's only accessible by car. Or inviting auto-oriented businesses into our village centers, which requires dismantling traditional scales, we see remnants of them here and here, for instance, and densities, and inserting homogenizing aesthetics to cookie cutter standards. These two shots are at routes 7 and 4 in Rockland. How dangerous this can be is illustrated by these two shots of Main Street in Hudson, New York, which managed to turn a place of character and history into what James Howard Kunstler called the geography of nowhere. This is something that happens incrementally. It's a bit like the victim in a slowly heating cannibal's pot. It's hard to say when it's going too far until it's happened. And this last danger was the trigger for the National Trust Declaration of Vermont as an endangered national treasure in 1993 and again in 2004. They and National Geographic Traveler recognized that Vermont was a special somewhere. In the 2004 trust citation, they wrote, and I quote, "With historic villages and downtowns, working farms, winding back roads, forest-wrapped lakes, spectacular mountain vistas, and a strong sense of community, Vermont has a special magic that led National Geographic Traveler magazine to name the state one of the world's greatest destinations." In fact, what they did was they said that Vermont was the number one destination in the United States, and it was tied internationally with Kyoto and Granada. They went on to cite the threat of big box and franchise invasions to this built environment, writing, quote, "The likely result, degradation of the Green Mountain State's unique sense of place, economic divestment in historic downtowns, loss of locally owned businesses, and an erosion of the sense of community." Fortunately, we do have countering forces that strive to keep us from soiling our nest. Act 250 includes impacts on historic resources among its concerns. The Division for Historic Preservation has extensively inventoried our historic building stock and continues to do so. And it has programs of grants to help nonprofits conserve their buildings, along with a downtown program with tax incentives for businesses and historic structures and town centers. And across the state, private citizens and communities have rallied to conserve their heritage. We have a history of narrowly dodging bullets, as with the pavilion building in Montpelier that was to be torn down for a modern state office building. It actually is a bit of a compromise here. It conserves the historic facades, but now wrapped around a new state office building in behind, but it has preserved the buildscape around the State House Green and on State Street. There's Windsor House that I mentioned earlier in Windsor. It was going to be torn down by the neighboring bank to create a drive-in facility and parking lot. and which drew a horrified editorial by Ada Louise Huxtable in the New York Times in 1972 that rallied state and local citizenry to purchase, restore, and adapt the building to new uses. Or there's the former Burlington Federal Savings and Loan of 1958, one of Vermont's few sophisticated modernist commercial buildings, built in the spirit of Skidmore, Owings, and Merrill steel and glass international-style business buildings like Lever House in New York and manufacturers Hanover Trust in New York. It was doomed by a later owner to be wrapped in a fake Victorian brick facade. And it was saved by a court case, by press reaction, and what has saved a lot of buildings in Vermont, finally, economic downturn. When the bank finally could afford to carry forth their project, the idea had sunk in that actually they should be proud of this building. And so they restored it with pride in 1998, and it was written up by the National Trust. Vermont was written up by the National Trust as one state that's intent on preserving its modernist heritage. Brattleboro, that has suffered from fire and flood, knows these experiences all too well. Yet much of what you have has been saved thanks to the action of citizens who recognize and care about the town's sense of place. You've got a group of heroes among you. I won't try to start naming them because I know I'm going to miss some of them if I do. But you are blessed with people who really are invested in Brattleboro as place, as historic place. The most recent triumph, of course, being the saving of the Brooks House, with the retention of its mixed-use residential, office, and small-scale commercial vitality. Through private citizen action, Vermont has been saving and restoring her historic theaters. From the large Burlington's Flynn, with its exciting marquee and its fabulous Art Deco interior, and Rutland's Beaux-Arts Paramount, that just celebrated its centennial, to the small, Bristol's Holly Hall, the Vergennes Opera House, and Derby Line's incredible Haskell Opera House that has its complete set of painted curtain and movable scenic flats, and of course the distinction of straddling the national border, so that the audience is in the United States and the performers are in Canada. An indication of the importance of these projects to their communities might be given by Middlebury's Town Hall Theater. This is an 1883 town hall and opera house that served subsequently as a movie theater. It had a car show in it, then a furniture store, then a bar and restaurant, and finally a Knights of Columbus Hall. It received a dropped ceiling and a barn board interior. The windows were bricked up, and the walls were starting to heave outward. And the Knights of Columbus had about six living members left and were unable to care for the building. It was beautifully and imaginatively restored through private community efforts as a venue for theater, professional theater, community theater, college theater, and children's theater. A venue for music, chamber music, big band music, folk music, and grand opera. These are some of the operas mounted there. Middlebury has its own opera company. It's a venue for live HD broadcasts of the Metropolitan Opera and the National Theatre of Britain. It hosts art and antique shows. It has an art gallery that changes exhibits monthly. It has housed farmers markets, wedding receptions, high school proms, business conferences, dance, yoga, and drama classes. In 1 year, it had over 300 booked events. You're in a better position than I to discuss the impact that something like the revitalization of the Latchis or the transformation of your railroad station into an art center can have on your community. You know, ventures like this enrich our Vermont quality of life. The integrity of our built heritage is all important to Vermont's image and its sense of place. Okay, beyond nostalgia, why is this important? Well, it's witness to the state's history, to where we've come from, to our values. Now, our buildings, many of them may be smaller in scale than the elaborate buildings in the rest of the country, but they are of at least as high a quality as can be found anywhere. They speak to our sense of community and of civic pride. And they conserve the quality of our landscape, which is no small part of the quality of life that we enjoy in this place. But the identity that our built environment establishes for the state is also key to our economy. Example for tourism. Witness the National Geographic Traveler's reaction to Vermont. We have yet to cash in on that, by the way. We keep stressing our ski areas and not stressing the full range of the Vermont environment as a goal for travelers, but also for value added for Vermont products. The state's image of grassroots integrity and quality rubs off on the likes of maple syrup, cheese, ice cream, coffee, wood stoves, wooden toys, microbrews, and bow ties. I mean, people buy Vermont maple syrup. They don't want upstate New York maple syrup or Ohio maple syrup. Yet those are other great, you know, maple syrup producers. But it's this image that gives value added to everything we do here. Vermont's architectural treasures are our treasures. But it takes a conscious public to understand that and to deal with the complexities of balancing our modern life with this precious heritage. To achieve this, we must first recognize and be mindful of the world-class value of what we have here, so that in the words inscribed in the Callis Meeting House, we remove not the ancient landmarks which the fathers have set. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben. We're going to take some questions, right?
I'd be happy to try to answer some. Yeah.
We have two microphones that we'll pass around, so just wait before you ask your question so you can get a microphone.
This gentleman right down here.
In our built heritage, is there a division between East and West, between Dutch and English?
We can find a few Dutch-related structures on the West side. There are regionalisms in Vermont, which are very interesting. You know, it's like terroir. We do have regional variants, and almost county by county. We have some Dutch-type masonry that came up from the Hudson Valley that we find up and down Lake Champlain, for example. We have pockets that are closer to Connecticut styles. One of the fascinating things is to look into the history of a community and see where the early settlers came from, and then look back to where they came from, and you find the same buildings, you know, in southeastern Connecticut, or Salisbury, Connecticut, or where they came up from the Hudson Valley, or from Massachusetts. If you look back to their hometowns, you're going to find the same kinds of buildings there in the first generations of building. And that has colored, that's one of the things that makes Vermont so rich, because we have people coming from so many places, and so we have wonderful examples still of architecture from all over New England.
Where's the other cobblestone house?
I don't know.
North Bennington.
North Bennington, okay. We have a cobblestone remodeled house in Middlebury that's actually going to be torn down soon. But that was a frame house that they just kind of, in the 1910s, stuck some cobblestones on, and it doesn't qualify. It's not the same kind of construction.
Is there any chance that there will be further research about documenting the buildings in this area?
Oh, one hopes.
It's all just hope.
Well, at this point, when a lot of the surveying was done, There were actually federal funds that helped finance that, and they're gone. And so it's a matter of the state setting priorities. They're heating up with the idea of survey work again. But we went through a period where the state just could not afford to do that, and almost all the efforts of the Division for Historic Preservation were going into environmental review for Act 250 and that kind of thing, which didn't necessarily win them a lot of friends. But survey is getting near the top again. But a lot of that has to be spurred by the local community. For instance, if your historical society wanted to spearhead this project, the state would welcome that. And actually, communities also can become what they call certified local governments. There's a category that has been set up nationally by the National Park Service called certified local governments. These are communities that have essentially a preservation committee or officer in them, and they gain special status. And there's a certain percentage of the federal funds that come to the state for preservation that are earmarked just for those communities. So that there may be, right now, about 14, 15 communities that are competing for the funds, Barbara, do you think? One of the things they do is they apply for these funds to help finance surveys, comprehensive surveys of their towns or districts. Bellows Falls has done survey after survey. It's one of the best surveyed communities in the state right now. I encourage people to consider through their town government getting listed as a certified local government and participating in this program. It's very helpful. It also has it helps finance educational programs, so that communities have set up walking tours and published brochures and done all kinds of things with those same kinds of funds. But Brattleboro is a black hole right now in comparison to many of the communities in the state. And yet, you've got it all right here. Yes?
Cobble Stone House.
I don't know.
North Bennington.
North Bennington, okay. We have a cobblestone remodeled house in Middlebury that's actually going to be torn down soon. But that was a frame house that they just kind of, in the 1910s, stuck some cobblestones on, and it doesn't qualify. It's not the same kind of construction. Any?
Is there any chance that there will be further research about documenting the buildings in this area?
Oh, one hopes.
It's all just hope.
Well, at this point, when a lot of the surveying was done, there were actually federal funds that helped finance that, and they're gone. And so it's a matter of the state setting priorities. They're heating up with the idea of survey work again. But we went through a period where the state just could not afford to do that, and almost all the efforts of the Division for Historic Preservation were going into environmental review for Act 250 and that kind of thing, which didn't necessarily win them a lot of friends. But survey is getting near the top again. But a lot of that has to be spurred by the local community. For instance, if your historical society wanted to spearhead this project, the state would welcome that. And actually, communities also can become what they call certified local governments. There's a category that has been set up nationally by the National Park Service called certified local governments. These are communities that have essentially a preservation committee or officer in them, and they gain special status. And there's a certain percentage of the federal funds that come to the state for preservation that are earmarked just for those communities, so that there may be right now about 14, 15 communities that are competing for the funds, Barbara, do you think? One of the things they do is they apply for these funds to help finance surveys, comprehensive surveys of their towns or districts. Bellows Falls has done survey after survey. It's one of the best surveyed communities in the state right now. I encourage people to consider through their town government getting listed as a certified local government and participating in this program. It's very helpful. It also has a it helps finance educational programs, so that communities have set up walking tours and published brochures and done all kinds of things with those same kinds of funds. But Brattleboro is a black hole right now in comparison to many of the communities in the state. And yet, you've got it all right here. Yes?
Areas of downtown buildings which seem to have the common stamped tin mm-hmm. ceilings, mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. do you know much about that? Or?
I don't know a great deal about it. And actually, with most of the buildings that are in that book, I've not been able to get inside them. But the interiors are things that tend to change more rapidly than the exteriors in many cases. But we have some really notable interiors around the state too, in our public buildings or publicly accessible buildings that we shouldn't be overlooking. Yes?
I know you can't cover everything in an hour or so, but one of the things that I always loved about Vermont is the small villages, the complex of small,
yes.
Houses around a central church. And mm-hmm. I think that's one of the very special things that most states
New England don't have. The Green in East Poultney. It's a total gem.
There's so many
yes.
of them.
Yes.
Yeah, and I think they're very special.
They are, definitely. And they're fragile because they're small, and it only takes one intrusion into a setting like that to spoil it. Which is also, of course, and I'll get on my bandstand here, it's one of the threats we have now with our to our landscape with our solar installations. Mm-hmm. There are well-placed ones, and they're mindlessly placed ones. And it only takes a few incursions into a landscape to spoil it for people. And so we really need to be mindful. Again, we have to be mindful of the whole of our heritage and figure out how to lead our modern lives, our progressive lives, without doing major damage to what we have.
Thank you. Some years ago, a preservationist from UVM spoke with regret about the loss of a gas station up where the courthouse now is,
okay.
because it was a distinctive design. On Putney Road now, there are two fast food restaurants side by side. I think KFC is one, I can't remember the other. And they're spectacularly grotesque. On the other hand, they are so distinctive and so remarkable in their garish appearance. I wonder if a case can be made for preserving certain structures like that, because they speak of an era, they speak of a commercial phase in our life, and a lot of people eat there.
This is actually a huge challenge for preservationists, because I mentioned that, for instance, our surveys don't include anything that's younger than 50 years of age. And there's a lot of vulnerable architecture out there in these most recent 50 years. And it includes our commercial strips, our commercial architecture, and old style motels, cabin courts. They're iconic types, and they're all part of our built history, but they're undervalued. Things have to become about 100 years old before people start really valuing them. And we have a lot of colonial revival architecture. We have a lot of 50s type ranch houses, things like this that they're threatened. And a lot of them are going to be lost. Actually, the important thing would be for us to try to survey and catalog the important examples. You know, we can pick out the things that are the really good examples of a building type right now. And if we could identify those things now, like that bank in Burlington, we could save them. And but it means that people also have to train their eye on modernism and not just on, you know, ye old.
Gee, I'd always marveled going through Chester at all those stone buildings, and you gave an explanation for that. But I wonder, I had heard that there was a train wreck. The train was carrying granite to New York City and it crashed there and all.
No. 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 But it's a very interesting type of construction, because Schenect-Ashler takes plates of stone and it will tie through the wall with a horizontal plate of stone, and then it'll face it with a vertical plate, and then it has a horizontal, and then it has a vertical. So what you're getting is these large faces of stone. It's not laid up like Ashlar masonry, course on course on course. And then they fill in the core of the wall with rubble. And Vermont is about the only place in the country where you can find this Schenect-Ashlar. So we've taught the nation a term that came from Scott. Any other questions? Yes.
I think this was wonderful. And the reason I'm saying that is that I'm in the field of restoring older buildings. And as a matter of fact, I was instrumental in the Brattleboro retreat going on the National Register, which is some years ago, mm-hmm. but that was a big, big job.
Oh, yes.
Which I did not understand when I got involved with it. And other ones. And at the moment, we are living in the Brooks House. And we have set up an exhibition on the first floor in the Brooks House atrium, and that's right in town, and that is, in case you don't know, that is 132 Main Street. Now, what I wanted to say is that at the moment we have an exhibition which we are showing, which is in the Brooks House atrium, which is a beautiful place by itself, and we have put in just about every work of art that we own, and it's all there. And what I'm saying is that at the moment the atrium is open for people to come in and look at these things, and they are works by my wife and myself, and the exhibition is called Side by Side, which means the two of us. And as a matter of fact, I see people that I did work with on various things here tonight, and I'm glad to see them. So if you, I have some literature here, so if anybody would like to talk to me, I'll be glad to talk to them and tell them whatever it is that they're interested in.
I had dinner in the Brooks House tonight, and all I can say is congratulations to the community on this effort, because it would have taken the heart out of downtown Brattleboro if you had lost that building, and it's really wonderful.
I was there when it was burning, and I can tell you it was a terrible thing to see. But the atrium there, it has gone through so many stages, and I remember that it was a bank at one time, and I think that anybody who wants to see something really interesting can go there. And as I say, there's no expense, and it's open, and at the moment, and I don't know how much longer it will be. So, if anybody is interested, the number that we have in our place there is 490-2561, and our name, Mariette and Steve Sanders.
Thank you. Anything else? Well, thank you.
Thank you very much, John. Just wanted to mention, we do have some, Glenn mentioned William Morris Hunt, and the library owns several of Hunt's paintings, The Prodigal Son, which is just beyond the screen there, that's one of them. And there are several others in the building. We have a guided tour if you're interested in checking out some of the art, so it's here.